I guess we'll do it that way. Episode 39, Part 1.
I love it. I've said so many times how I wish I could have like a little DJ soundboard.
I feel like now though, every time I tell a story, you're gonna punchline it with that fart sound. Exactly.
I love this podcast so much more than I used to.
I don't know who would abuse that fart button more, you or my 7-year-old. It's a toss-up, for sure.
Oh, John.
Here we are, back from the dead.
Oh, man. John, what's the latest?
Well, I woke up early this morning and took my kids to school, went and helped my dad do some stuff at his house. We went over and fixed a deck for an invalid. And, exactly. Oh, no. Oh dear!
Does this person enjoy being referred to as the invalid?
TBH, I don't know their name. I went over.
Just some pathetic sick person.
Just some.
I bet 96% of our audience is invalids because oh. I would listen to a lot of podcasts if I was stuck in the house all day.
So yeah, so I'm out here jacking up decks in North Georgia. What are you up to, my dude? Did you just finish something recently?
Nah, I just been putzing around playing Zelda on Nintendo Switch.
Right. Did you get the Ocarina of Time yet?
The what?
The Ocarina of Time.
You can tell I haven't actually played Zelda yet.
Ooh.
Yeah, dude, finished this movie, which was nuts.
Yeah. How did everything shake out?
Oh man, John, don't tempt me with such an open-ended question.
Nailed him. I don't need a sound box to do fart sounds, baby.
People are like, yeah, but the best part is because it's the same every time.
We definitely just lost our Islamic Republic listeners for sure. Mahmoud is too crude.
I'm amazed they stuck with us this long. Yeah, dude, the movie was absolutely crazy. I'm tired of saying that. I feel like everyone's probably tired of hearing it, but...
Well, tell us why it was crazy.
Well, okay. There were a few times where we were on set and we had a good day.
Yeah.
And I was kind of joking. The first time that really happened where we were just like, dang, we just whooped that day's ass. I pulled Johnny Ray, who plays Rufus, pulled him aside. And I was like, hey, dude. Because he had like so many lines that day and we had like so many complicated camera things and stuff to do. And I was like, yo, you know what we just did? We just took that day, took that whole day of shooting, all those scenes. We kind of put our hand on its shoulder. We kind of tapped it on the cheek in a really patronizing way.
Mm.
And then we were like, get the fuck in the can.
Mm.
And it did. And it just walked off with its tail between its legs and was like, yes, sir. That's kind of what we did to this movie, dude. We were like, get in the can. And it did. It was just like, yes, okay, fine. I'll go in. It was like a genie in a bottle. It was just like, get the fuck in there. And it was like, we were like, it was okay.
Yeah.
Zoop, 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 zoop. That's what it did. So I'm feeling pretty good.
Yeah, you should. Well, usually you try to get the genie out of the bottle, but you guys stuck it back in to be released at another date.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. A movie is this genie, and it's unwieldy, and you have to wield it.
It's a genie that grants one wish, the wish to see a great movie.
Exactly. John, you're so insightful.
Mm. So you think everything went well?
I do. And again, I'm not saying, I like to set low expectations, not high.
Sure.
But I do genuinely think that it is an excellent project.
Yeah. And we know from talking to you that you had an editor on set frequently.
Mm-hmm. Mari.
And
yep.
You've probably seen how much of the movie now? Not totally completed, obviously, but a rough cut of how much?
Honestly, I haven't watched a lot.
Okay.
I have seen scenes totaling maybe, I've maybe watched 12 scenes out of technically like 80 something, but I've seen more than technically 12 scenes. Like I've probably seen a quarter of the movie.
Right.
But honestly, I haven't watched much of it. I haven't watched a lot of dailies like we talked about. Mm-hmm. I haven't really gotten into the edit.
When will the edit start in earnest?
As soon as this podcast ends.
Really? You'll go over and meet with Mari?
No, I'm doing it. We're co-editing.
Yeah.
And I have a couple drives at my house now, and I have a computer. I sprung for a Mac Mini.
Okay.
And a monitor because I was like, I'm not going to edit this movie on a laptop.
Sure.
That's a little silly. And my laptop, I tried. My laptop was too slow. So I went and got a Mac Mini. I'm sitting at what will now be the official editing station for me. Mari has her own setup kind of at home. But yeah, we're starting. I mean, we looked at some stuff yesterday, kind of came up with a process. You know, there's so much data. Like there's so many, I want to say thousands of clips. I don't know. There's an insane number.
Yeah.
And they all have to be synced with sound, and they all have to be organized, and they all have to be, you know, because we filmed them all on different days, and they all have to get back in order and all that kind of crap. So that was a lot of what Mari was doing, as well as like putting together kind of rough assemblies of various scenes. And now what we're going to both start doing is going in and picking. I mean, the real plan is basically we're going to pick several scenes that feel like they could be close soon and kind of massage them. Mm. And then we're going to do what's called a show and tell, or at least we're calling them that with a couple of our executive producers who are like sales and sort of into that world. And we're going to basically show it to them and be like, what do you think we should do with this? You know, like here's some scenes, here's a deck. These are some materials that you could use. Do you think, what festival should we, like, you know, gut check how we're feeling about certain things and get them excited about it and see kind of what the next step is going to be.
And these are people that are, oh boy. These are people that are already involved in the project. Like I met two of the.
Did you meet Tiffany and Elsa?
Yeah. So that's who you're talking
that's
about.
Who
that's
we're
who
doing
you
it
would
with.
Go to.
Yep.
And you would show them the completed project, and you would say to them...
Oh, no. We would show them, like...
Parts.
Three scenes or something.
Right. And you say to them, where should we show this? And they say to you, you're the producer. You're supposed to tell us this kind of stuff.
Right. They basically, I think, will say... I'm going to go in, and I'm going to say, Tiffany, I want to go to a cool festival. And I think Toronto would be a good option because it's in the fall and I like Toronto, and Toronto is a major international festival with a legit market and it's a cool festival. And she's going to be like, yo, it's really hard to get in Toronto. I don't know if you can do that. And I'm going to be like, I know, but do you think this movie is good enough? And I hope she's going to say, yeah, this movie kicks ass. Let me call everyone I've ever known and see about how we can start getting you to submit the movie and have someone who actually makes decisions watch it. Because sometimes you end up with like, you never know who's going to watch it. Like, that's the biggest thing about getting into these things is, like, if you can have some sort of inside track, everyone watches every movie that gets submitted, but if you can have some sort of inside track, it's not necessarily, like, going to get you in, but it might mean that somebody with a little bit more pull sees it a little earlier before it kind of gets filtered through the system accidentally.
And these EPs, executive producers that you're going to go meet with, they're industry people.
Yes.
I thought they were just like, Your Honor, like that kind of lawyer.
Oh, no. That's why they're EPs, because that, like, Tara and I really tried to make sure that every EP on the project is bringing a lot of value, you know?
Gotcha.
And Tiffany and Elsa. Elsa is the founder and sort of head of our law firm. Her partner, Erica, is her lawyer. And then Tiffany is another partner at the firm, but she focuses on sales.
Gotcha.
And then, I mean, I got to talk to Tiffany. I think, like, she kind of wants to try to take some of the stuff out and see about possibly getting me repped as a director, which would be really cool. I don't know, man. There's a ton. It's weird looking at the movie because If everyone can hear like a jackhammer in the background, I'm very sorry.
Can't hear it.
Good.
It's just the sound of new ground being broken, y'all.
Look at... You know what that sound is?
Oh boy. Still catches me off guard.
I think, John, I feel like, man, it's going to take me a minute to warm up because I am tired. I'm not even saying that. Like, don't cut that out. This is like just me saying I don't yet feel myself again.
Yeah. Well, you know, I told you this before, but we got this little dog and he ate my headphones. And I am so...
I did not know that, actually. Your AirPods?
No, my like plug-in ones that I plug in to use for the podcast.
Got it.
He chomped them and destroyed them like the first day I had him. He's much better.
Boy.
He's actually sleeping like a nice little smoocher at my feet as we speak.
Oh, little buddy. How old is this young boy?
Who knows? But he chewed my... he's about two, 3 months. He chewed
he's
my
a
headphones.
Baby.
And I keep forgetting to get new ones because I have, you know, ones that plug into my phone, so I never think about it. But now I'm using my son's headphones that he got to like take some test at school, and it sounds... they're the type of headphones that go in your ear, but they're so crappy. I'm waiting for that tone to come in, like the, you know, the hearing test. Did you ever take those?
Oh, they're like that.
Yeah, I had those. Ew. Now I have in-ear ones, but the sound is so bad. It's like the headphones you get on a plane or something. So you're trying to warm up. It sounds like you're talking to me through the ocean or something.
What if I am? What if I am talking to you through the ocean?
It seems possible.
What if I'm talking to you? What if we have another shitty audio episode? Everyone will quit listening.
No.
Man, John, I don't know. I'm kind of going through a little something right now, man.
Yeah.
It's a weird experience.
My wife does shows, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Every day, I've seen this, you know, 10,000 times now because we've been married for forever. And
she does what, four a year, five a year?
They do, well, they're about, I think next week they start or the week after, and they do like six of these shows, man.
Woo.
But when they're done,
baby,
it's such a process, and it's, you know, it's a high level, even though it's high school. She's quite...
Oh, yeah, no, they're legit shows.
Legit shows, but the kids always crash, dude. The last night, they're like so excited, and they do the best job they've done yet. And then about an hour after they've gotten their flowers and their grandma's giving them chocolates and hugged them, they inevitably, like 50% of them start crying for the rest of the night.
Yes.
It's a huge emotional toll, man.
You know, I wished that you guys were around. What's that?
Have you cried since the last day of shooting?
No.
Yeah. Well, you told us last time or several times ago that you do not cry.
I would like to. I'm waiting to cry. I think an opportunity is going to come, and I will definitely cry.
Right. Maybe it'll be good.
No, I'm actually looking forward to it. I'll put it this way, John. The last 8 weeks, you know, which I would consider like the last 8 weeks effectively have been kind of like full-time rollers, hardcore 12 to 16 hours a day minimum type days for 8 weeks, which I'm not complaining. I'm just...
it's a lot.
Saying it's a lot, and I care a lot, you know, like I care a lot. And I am not sure what that will result in, you know, like it meaning, I guess I'm just still thinking it all through because, like, I feel like I sort of foreshadowed this a little bit, but now I can kind of confirm that it's real. Like, this project, in ways that I never expected, took it out of me, you know? Like,
sure.
And I'm not burned out, just to be clear. I'm thrilled, but I am at this weird stage where I don't know that I've ever felt like this because I've possibly maybe been this sort of tired at some point, but I don't know that I had the emotional awareness to diagnose it, you know? And I think making this kind of an interesting phase of my life, but man, like I just feel like I just went through something, you know? Like I feel like I don't want to overstate it, but I feel like I just did like the Iditarod or something. Like I feel like I just did something that is kind of supposed to kill you, and it weirdly was the most fun I've ever had.
Really?
John, I don't even know where to begin with how much I love making movies. I love everything about it.
That can't possibly be true, but we'll get there.
I feel like I just, you know the feeling when you like go on a really hard hike?
Yeah.
And you're like, this level of exhaustion is good for me in some way. And I don't want to do it every day. And also, because it's such a hard hike, I did something that I think very few people do. And because, and that makes it interesting and unique of it as an experience. And a lot of other people that I really, 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 really like also did the same exact thing. And we all did it together at the same time.
Right.
And because of all of that, that makes the whole thing better. You know, like the harder the hike, the more satisfying the view at the end, you know?
Oh, totally. Yeah, if you don't lose a limb or something.
And I'm not even close to the end yet. That's part of what I'm realizing. Yeah. No, totally. But like, that's what I'm starting to realize is just, it's A, like, wow, this was a long road. And B, weirdly, this is like the base camp.
Right.
Like, this is like base camp in a way. And so there's part of me that's like, I don't know, man. I'm still, it's a lot. It's a lot to think about. But I really do love it.
Yeah. Whenever I talk to anybody about this, you know, a lot of people around here have asked me what's going on. Like people at church or friends, mutual friends of ours are like, what's up with the movie? What's going on with saying now that he's done?
Mm-hmm.
And I tell everybody, you know, I tell them what's going on, but my like bigger picture view of all this is like that. This is, it's so much work to even get this ball rolling, right? To get to a place where you can credibly say, not just say it, people say shit all the time, but to credibly say, I'm going to make a movie soon. That's huge. Then to assemble the pieces and even start. How many movies have started and never finished, I wonder? I don't know.
Right,
I doubt it's
right.
A lot, because I don't think that many movies are getting made.
It's a lot, though.
Yeah, but I bet it's a number.
It actually is a lot.
I bet it is. And then to actually complete all of this, like just from the big picture view, if you were watching this from a distance, you'd be like, holy shit, it's impressive already. If this movie, for whatever crazy reason, doesn't see the light of day, to me, it almost doesn't matter. Or even say like there are masterpieces that go unnoticed. Like I was thinking about Citizen Kane. I was talking to somebody about Citizen Kane. It had like a month long run before they tried to bury it. And for how many years? Like 30 years that movie was not really seen or appreciated.
Wow.
I'm sure these numbers are wrong and somebody's pulling their hair out, but relax.
No, but the idea is there.
The idea is
no,
true.
No, you're right, man. I appreciate that.
But the other part of
Let's stay on that for a sec.
It's not the end. The other part of that, though, is what happens or like what's the... There is a possibility that this, for whatever reason, does nothing or virtually nothing.
Right?
Like you go to some festivals and then that's the end of it. In fact, you've had experience with
other
movies.
It's more likely that that happens.
It's much more, not much more, but it's more likely than not, right?
Much more likely than likely.
Right. So how do you feel? Not to
even
project,
at this point, yeah.
Yeah, does that factor in at all to your feeling now? Are you like, dude, we just did it. We ran the race. It's amazing. Doesn't matter if we win. Doesn't matter if we win next year. We just did it. Is that how you feel? Or is there some part of you that's like nervous about the future for this film?
That's a good question. I want to give you a good answer. I'm going to think on it for a second. No, I've been thinking about this for a long time. You know,
yeah.
We've been talking about it a lot. And I think probably the best way to sum it up would be.
Yes, sir.
I think the best way to, I think the best way to answer that, I feel like this was the greatest professional experience of my life.
Yeah.
I met people that I would like to work with for the next 40 years. And I don't say that with any shred of exaggeration.
Yeah.
I realized that I am deeply, deeply passionate about making movies because I think it, I feel like the last 29 years of my life in some very strange ways have prepared me to not only love it, but to do it pretty decently well.
Right.
I think. And to your point, those are some big freaking things. That's a lot. You know, like I told Kelly, I weirdly feel like there was a period of time where I was like, you know, to put it in a different context, I'm always sort of putting it in different contexts because I just don't know how to process this myself. So I'm trying to put it in context of like things that I've seen other people go through, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, I want to go to an Ivy League school, you know, like I want to go to Harvard. And everybody's like, dude, that's so hard. Like, just go to the state school down the road. And it's like, yeah, that's the state school down the road is freaking great. But like, I specifically want to study with the people that only teach at Harvard. And it's not an elitism thing. It's not that I don't think there's lots of good stuff to learn other places. It's just this group of people is doing, they're the only group, this group of 20 people, you know, they're one of 20 schools in the world that's doing the level of research that I want to be a part of, you know?
Right.
So
yeah.
There's nothing elitist about wanting to go there. You just freaking have to.
That's if you're going to be a doctor, you have to go to med school, period.
Right. But it's also like, I don't want to just be a doctor because there's nothing wrong with just being a doctor in like a small town. That's incredibly admirable. But for me, I'm kind of like, I sort of want to try to figure out how to do something big. You know, like I sort of want to start down the very slow and long 50-year path of trying to cure cancer. That's I don't at all say that movies are even 100th of the importance of curing cancer, but in terms of the size of, like, I only say cancer because it sounds impossible. And to me, I weirdly want to try to make art that feels impossibly deep and impossibly good. You know, like I think that's increasingly becoming my goal, because even just while making this movie, I realized how much I love the process of enriching things and making layers fold in on themselves and deepening things and fighting for perfect performances and fighting for hilarious jokes as opposed to sort of funny passable jokes, and finding deep, seriously surprising little emotional moments. Like, I'm realizing that specifically is what's exciting to me about all of this. Not just in movies, but, and I only spend so much time articulating that because that has always been the goal, but I think there is a big question in my mind about whether or not I would enjoy the process of making a movie, because it is so different than I ever expected. And I knew it would be different than I expect. I mean, you were there. Like, I think everyone has a different experience. Like, I think some people are like, wow, this is phenomenally tedious. You know, it's so much waiting and so much doing the same thing over and over and over and over and over. And then some people are like, wow, it seems like too much. I just want to focus on one thing or whatever. And all of those are good. But for me, I'm kind of like, wow, I even love the challenge of trying to create a working environment for 20 plus people where after 20 plus days, they all still like each other. You know, like, to me, even
give us
that
an example
is
of that
part of what's interesting.
Tell us how you did that. If you did it, how'd you do it?
I don't know how I did it. I might have to reflect on that more. And I don't know if I did. I mean, that's something that I want to talk to people who were part of the movie about. You know, like, I think that's going to be...
Oh, baby.
Let's preview some episodes, John.
Oh, this is what we
do. And then
best
I want to
answer
your question.
We have
I know.
We I think 90% of our episodes are teasing. future episodes. So I know, let's do it now.
That's why
we're
people
best
come
at.
Back. That's why people come back.
Next week.
I want to have a serious period of debrief because people have stuck with us for 39 episodes already without really hearing a lot about the movie.
Yeah.
And I want to spend an appropriate amount of time talking about what happened from as many angles as is humanly possible.
Yeah, before we start on that, have I ever told you about the pyramids? Just kidding.
Oh, John, this is why I need you in my
who
life.
Who would be the first person?
Tara, yeah. Just to be honest, Tara likes being behind the scenes. I have a feeling it's going to be tough to get her excited about being on the show.
Yeah, I feel like we could coax her out, though. Shout out to Tara. Tara, remember when you told me around that kitchen that great ghost story that I have now repeated all over the country? Come on, Tara. You got a lot to share.
Tara, we'll just get her a little drunk or something. It'll be good.
Bingo.
No, there will be some structure. I think what I do want to do, though, I want to talk to the actors and be like, what I'm actually going to meet hopefully with one of our actors, Kate, soon. And I'm just going to be like, Kate, what was your experience of this movie like?
Right.
You know, let's get deep about that. And I want to do that off air with people, but I do also want to do it on air. Anyway, preview episodes, there's going to be a lot of that. And I'm excited about it because I think it's going to take a minute to unpack all of this, in part because some of it will change as the edit continues, you know, and right. and the edit, the next step is based, like I said, like I'm not gonna dive into the whole movie yet. Like I'm not gonna watch a rough cut. I could watch a rough cut today. It would be incomplete in certain small areas, but like I could technically watch a rough cut, but I actually want to wait as long as I possibly can before I watch a rough cut, because I am in this like hyper sensitive focused mode where every detail kind of seems important, which is what I sort of prepared myself to do for the movie. And I want to stay there for a bit, because as soon as I watch a 2 hour and 15 minute cut of this ridiculous movie, I'm going to be like, oh my gosh, there's so many like big macro level problems that I need to solve. And then I'm going to lose sight of the micro stuff. So I'm trying to stay in the micro, which is hard because, man, there's part of me that wants to just watch this fucking movie already. But I'm trying to be patient.
Yep.
So what was the question that I so successfully diverted us from?
I don't know, but now I'm on another diversion because I want to know what you mean. What type of macro stuff? Are you actually talking about editing like smaller scenes, or are you talking about other micro stuff? What do you mean by that?
Yes. No, specifically, I mean like macro. An example of macro would be like this 35 minute chunk of the movie feels slow.
Gotcha.
And like moving scenes around, and like these two scenes butt up too close to each other without like, you know, it's that kind of stuff. The beginning feels weird. The ending's boring, you know, big stuff. I want to focus on, do I like this performance or this performance?
Gotcha.
And do I want to put that next to this performance or this performance? And does it matter to me that that thing isn't perfect in the background? You know what I mean? Like that kind of stuff.
Yeah. I wonder if you start that way, will you run into problems?
Meaning like putting too much work into it too early?
Sort of, but also if you notice that there's a big, say like the first 30 minutes are too slow and you got it, but you've already spent time like meticulously going through and picking which version of this 2 minute interaction is the best one,
you might cut that
anyway. So now you've spent a whole day looking at this little scene that you've cut later.
Right. That's part of the risk I'm taking.
But it's a risk you're willing to take, huh?
It's a risk I'm willing to take because one of the things that I learned about directing, and I will continue to learn this in new ways, but one of the big things I learned is that one of my biggest jobs as a director is to always have the whole movie in my head at all times.
Right.
And to know how each thing is going to be a part of the movie. Because as much as I try, no one else has the whole movie in their heads. It's not possible to communicate it to all of them. They all have about ranging from 1 to 45% of the movie in their heads, but they don't have 100% because I can't articulate it all. So my job, starting with the script, my job throughout the process has been to sort of answer those questions. Like the process of deciding if the movie's working on a macro level, I think what I'm trying to say is that diagnosis is only accurate if I'm looking at scenes that actually reflect what I want those scenes to be.
Yeah.
You know, like I can't tell if the movie, and again, it's a risk, but like I can't tell if the movie's slow if I'm watching a version of six scenes and all of them are much, much, much slower than I want them to be. Of course the movie's slow. Every single scene that I'm watching is slower than I want it to be. So it's like, part of what I'm trying to do is this weird, like from the beginning, it's been tough to get people excited about the project without having like at least one really good conversation, because it's not as simple as like, oh, there's this story that's really compelling. Now let's build stuff around it. It's like, it's always been this like little weird contained world. And a lot of things are dependent on each other to make sense. You know, like the comedy is really dependent on the delivery, and like the jokes are very sort of like, for instance, we talked about this a lot on set. The comedy in Rollers is very rarely it borrows from very broad tropes, but at the end of the day, the comedy in Rollers is much more situational than I think people expect, and in some cases, other people read Rollers and they're like, oh, this is just kind of like a drama that's a little funny. And I'm like, no, it's kind of both. Like it's very silly and slapstick even at times. But that might also happen. There's a fart joke at the end of a very dramatic scene between two characters who used to be best friends. And it's like a lot of people throughout the process have been like, that doesn't make any sense. And I agree. But then there's also this part of me that's like, but you just have to see it. Like you just have to understand who these people are and these characters. And in that particular case, you have to know who Rufus is. And Rufus uses comedy as defense. That's what we talked about a lot. You know, like Johnny Ray and I, honestly, all of us. I said, you guys use jokes and sarcasm and you poke fun at each other as a way to protect yourselves.
Right.
And that is what this comedy is. And so I started creating like frameworks like that, where I'm like, Donnie is another character. He's very silly. He's kind of the dumb best friend, at least in an archetype sense. But he's much different than that because like I talked to Kevin and we like developed, and it's written to be a much more complicated character. But like on the surface, it feels that way. So in some ways, like Donnie's dumb and Donnie's broad and all these kinds of things. But you know, there's nuance to that because really Donnie's actually not dumb. Donnie appears dumb because the thing that drives his humor is joy, and he's not anxious. He comes from a position of like, life is good. Let's enjoy it. Let's be chill. And he sees threats to that as negatives. You know what I mean? Like he's coming from a very healthy standpoint in a way. He's a voice of reason, even though he's very silly. Whereas Rufus is coming from this place of anxiety where everything is a potential threat. And so even comedy is a way to protect himself from people who he's close to. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah. I was just going to say, I've read the script now, you know, not now, but I've read the script and I've even seen these people acting these parts out. And what you're saying makes perfect sense. Like two of the scenes, one of the scenes we have, it's towards the end that I saw filmed was when Johnny is standing up in front of the crowd and he says like, I was going to give a speech, but fuck it. You know?
Yeah. I realized it sucked.
Yeah. It's that thing, you know, he's in front of a crowd of a bunch of people and he's self-deprecating and like cutting himself down.
Yeah.
But that's the joke too.
It's both the joke and it's revealing. It's kind of this little nod to the audience where it's like, yeah, he sort of got his shit together, but he's still the same person. He still has wounds. You know, he's not going to all of a sudden get up there and just be this like supremely confident, perfect person. Like he's still saying goodbye to this place, spoiler. And anyway, that to me is one of the things that I learned. And I think that is a micro example. You know, for instance, like making sure that each scene respects that is the tone of the movie. Being like, no, actually, that cheap joke or that sentimental line in that scene, I don't need to watch it as part of the entire movie to know that it doesn't fit mm-hmm. the vibe of the movie that we're trying to make right now.
Right.
And so I want to, that's more what I'm talking about in terms of the order.
Got you. So you sent me this deck.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I did.
I'm curious, like, this is
I feel bad teasing it because we can't send it out.
Right, I was going to say. Yeah,
it's crazy, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's quite good.
That's part of what we're going to be using, ideally, to get people excited about the movie. Tell it and be like, hey, does this look like a small movie to you? Does it look like a little indie bullshit movie? No, didn't think so. Don't you want to buy it? That's what I hope people will. You know what I mean?
Holy mackerel. Dude, that just makes me nervous hearing you say that. Not because it's not true.
No, dog.
But the idea of that, of going out there and trying to sell this just sounds...
Oh, dude, you'll be along for the whole thing, baby.
Is it daunting to you, or is it like, dude, I'm so excited to show this to people?
Oh, that's where we were going earlier. John, here's the deal. I'm going to be hideously, hideously honest with you, as always. No, I'm just kidding. This feels so serious. I feel so serious right now.
No, hit us.
Just feels so serious. The other day we were at the party. We had an epic rap party at Rollers. It was...
Oh, nice.
It was so delightful. Like, everyone came. We just had so much fun. Everybody was just so glad to be there. And, like, we were just having... We did karaoke. Everybody sang. I mean, it was so... completely ridiculous. Okay, John, so you asked me a very insightful question.
No, me? What was it?
What was it? Who asked me some questions?
Dad? The person that we went to fix this deck for this morning, my dad was kind of giving me one of these, like, do it for the least of these kind of things, you know?
Yeah.
So we go out there, and it's a pretty rough situation, dude. But this girl, this grown person, like, opens a window of this pretty ramshackle house and just is yelling, Dad! Dad! Like, one of my kids would not even do this, you know? And it was, like, you know, 30-something-year-old adult yelling for their, like, 60-something-year-old parent.
Oh,
Dad!
No.
It was,
oh boy.
I didn't even know what to do, man.
Oh boy.
Anyway, Dad.
That's bleak. That's bleak.
My dad and I fixed that deck and got the heck out of there.
You're like, we'll help you, but we definitely don't want to spend any time with you.
I was telling my dad, I was like, Dad, you go to church with these people. They already know the gospel. Like, this is not our calling, my dude. Let's go.
That is so the opposite of what the whole Bible's about, but that's okay.
I know. He was nudging me. I'm joking. We did it.
I know you are. But, here's the deal. Okay. Well, you were going to say something.
No, I was going to try to lead us back in. So go. Are you nervous about showing this around? You're going to be hideously honest.
No. Here's the deal. I'm going to be hideously honest, John. I totally agree with what you said, which is it's been such a phenomenal, beautiful, growth inspiring challenge.
Yeah.
An artistic experience. You know, like, I did not know what I was doing before this, and I went into it with a bunch of people who kind of sort of knew what they were doing, and we all made ourselves available, and I think we captured some very cool stuff, and that was the point of that phase. Now, I am entering another phase where I will try to shape that stuff, those options that I have, into a cohesive experience that is consumable by a mass audience.
Right.
That is my next goal. And so in some ways I look at the first goal as like, holy shit, we got to the top of the mountain, right? Mm-hmm. That was the goal. But the actual goal from day one was actually to sort of like go to the top of the mountain in a way that no one has gone to the top of this particular mountain. So in some ways, like the discovery process was part of it. And then in other ways, getting home safely and then writing about it is another part. And so like the goal is not to get to the top of a mountain and die. You know, the right. goal is to get to the top of the mountain and come home. And so I think in some ways what I'm trying to say is like I couldn't be more thrilled and satisfied with the way things went. And yet I am, as a result of being this excited, I am more excited than I've ever been to show the fruit of our labor to these people, especially to the people who threw themselves out there to make this thing, because mm-hmm. most of them have seen nothing.
Right.
They've seen like two clips, you know, like honestly, mm-hmm. dude, a lot of the people who worked on the movie didn't even read the script. They don't even know what's going on.
Is that true? They're just there.
Like,
are you talking about like groups and stuff?
Yeah, yeah. I'm talking about like usually like all the technical roles. Yeah, yeah. But still, like they're hugely important. And some of them came in like halfway through the movie. You know, like they came in like on day 12.
Yeah.
Like we had different people every day. There were people, new people on set every single day in crucial roles, you know?
I pictured when you said that people didn't read the script, I just pictured Johnny Ray Gill being like, line, like every other word.
Oh, John. Not Johnny Ray. Not Johnny Ray, but wow, dude, I'm going to preview. We could do a whole episode on our last day.
What do you mean? So people didn't know their shit?
The last day of Rollers was the most Rollers day I can possibly imagine.
Oh, baby.
Yes, sir, indeed it is. What's up, y'all? It's little Johnny Bear out here kicking it. Figure if Uncle Zay can finish this movie, I can do the closing credits in my natural voice. This show's produced by me and Uncle Zay. I edited this jam. Feel it. Opening songs, Flute Loop by the Beastie Boys. This song is Stay Fly for the 3-6 Mafia. Nate Giordano does our cover art. And that's it, man. That's it. It's a Mama Bear production, baby. Part 2. Coming soon.